a very, very good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and a very warm welcome. My role now is very, very brief. I'm going to ask His Eminence, the Archbishop Nikitas, for his blessing, and then the President of the University is going to continue, and the Dean of Cass Business School, and Mr. Sir Thimios Mitropoulos, representative of Maria Tsakos Foundation. That's all for the time. Your Eminence.
Good morning to all. Καλημέρα σας. Josan. Boker Tov. Bueno Dumenatze. The many languages of the world and many more. But we may pray in unity of faith and harmony and ask for God's blessings. This will be a semi-Orthodox prayer because it will begin in the name of the Trinity but become more inclusive because I'm sure all those here are not Orthodox Christians. And the love and the mercy of God are for all people. Blessed is our God, always, now, and ever, to the ages of ages. Amen. O Lord God of our fathers, you protected Noah as he sailed upon the waters. You protected him, his family, and all those now who sail upon the seas. Send down your grace, your mercy, your peace, your love, and your guidance, not only upon this institution, but the individuals in the institutions here represented, those connected with the seas, either through shipping, trade, finance, employment. Give them strength and encouragement. Teach them to abide by the law and the truth which you instill in the hearts of all people. Make the waters safe. Preserve them pure. Guide your people to safe ports. Let peace come upon the face of the earth and preserve your people. Teach us fair trade through all your institutions and guide your people to the abundance of knowledge, mercy, and love so that we may do your good works upon the face of the earth and let us bring wholeness, unity, and love to all people. Amen.
I could also add my welcome and a very good morning. Dr. Costas Grammenos, Your Excellency Archbishop Nikitas, Your Excellencies, my Lords, our eminent speakers and guests. A warm welcome to the combined 35th anniversary event for the Costas Grammenos Centre for Shipping, Trade and Finance and the 9th City of London Biennial Meeting. The theme for our meeting, as you'll see behind me, is This World is Changing. The Biennial Meeting provides a platform for dialogue between leading figures from the City of London and other capital cities and has become the major event of its kind in the calendar for the City of London. It's sponsored by the Maria Tsakos Foundation and has attracted around 1,300 attendees from the UK and overseas, including policymakers, diplomats, business leaders, and senior academics. Many of them, as you will no doubt know, are graduates from the Shipping, Trade and Finance Centre at Cass Business School, City, University of London. Among the subjects to be discussed over the next 3 days include world economy, banking and finance, energy and commodities, environment and regulation, shipping and shipping finance, technology, innovation and trade. The speakers and the chairs are, as always, leading international personalities in their fields. And on this occasion, we're also delighted to include our graduates who have distinguished themselves internationally. We are proud of them, as we are of all graduates of the Costas Grammenos Centre for Shipping, Trade and Finance. Before we proceed with the meeting, and for the benefit of those who don't know City University of London too well, I'll bring you up to date with just a few words on our recent progress. City was established 125 years ago, so it's our anniversary this year. We were established in 1894, and we've come a long way since gaining university title in 1966. We have very strong connections with the City of London. The city's worshipful companies supported us and have done since Victorian times, and the Lord Mayor of London is our rector. We have around 20,000 students, of whom over half are from the UK, 11% from the rest of the European Union, and as you know, many are from Greece, and around 30% from around the globe. Over 40% are postgraduates. In recent years, we've invested heavily in outstanding members of academic staff from around the world, developed our existing staff, and transformed our estate and, of course, our infrastructure. And our investments have brought impressive returns. We've nearly tripled the proportion of our academic staff, producing world-leading or internationally excellent research, and improved the satisfaction of our students by more than any other university in the country. And to signal our new status to the world, we recently became an autonomous member of the University of London, and are now part of a much larger group that includes organisations you'll have heard of, UCL, King's, Queen Mary, LSE, LBS, Royal Holloway, SOAS, and so on. It's my very great pleasure now to declare this meeting open and to hand over to Professor Paolo Volpine, Interim Dean of Cass Business School, to say a few words about Cass. Thank you.
All right, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. So as the Interim Dean of Cass Business School, I'm honored to be here this morning. It's a truly special occasion, and it's wonderful to see you all here. At Cass, we've been at the leading edge of business education for 50 years, aspiring for excellence and constantly seeking new ways to serve our students and alumni and shape business practice and policy. Our, of course, internationally renowned Center for Shipping, Trade and Finance is the jewel in the crown of Cass Business School, and it's a central part of our school. Under the wise leadership of Costas Grammenos, of course, the center has pioneered postgraduate studies in shipping, trade, finance and energy, as you know, offering the first specialist MSc degrees in these disciplines. As you know, the center was established by Costas in 1983 and was renamed in his honor in April 2007. Through its unique blend of theory and practice, it has gained international recognition among industry leaders, policymakers, government, and academics. But the center is really a lot more than a space for knowledge, learning, and thought leadership. It's a family, often with many generations of the same family, fathers, mothers, daughters, sons, uncles, and aunts, studying with us. And we are absolutely incredibly proud of that. These students go on to form a valued alumni community and stay part of the center after they graduate. Indeed, the center has a network of 3,500 alumni from over 160 countries, and many of them are here today, either as delegates or speakers. This is a testament to Costas' leadership of the center and the tremendous work of all its staff who have come together to build this very special community. Our alumni are a key part of Cass Business School. You have enabled, Costas, our remarkable climb, and you're shaping and achieving our collective ambitions for the future. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you all for coming to the International Maritime Organization today, and I hope you have a wonderful time over the next 3 days. Thank you all. I have to welcome Sir Eftimios Mitropoulos. Mitropoulos.
Your Eminence, Excellencies, Prime Minister, Dean, Lord Sterling, fellow speakers, chairmen, panelists and discussants, media representatives, Celia, dear alumni and students, my lords, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It always fills me with joy to come to this building in which I have spent more than three decades in the service of IMO. For this, I thank my dear friend, the founding chairman of the City of London Meetings, Professor Costas Grammenos, for inviting me to assist in this conference and thus share my views with prominent figures of the international maritime community on some of the most challenging and, I dare add, thorniest items on the shipping industry's contemporary agenda. Those who have crossed paths with Costas should consider themselves fortunate. And I think we should all recognize his immense contribution to the industry from many aspects, not least for founding the Center for Shipping, Trade and Finance, which rightfully bears his name. For us Greeks, Costas is a source of pride, and we thank him for flying our flag with dignity and distinction so high. As chairman of the Maria Tsakos Foundation, which is a public benefit foundation, which in its mission statement includes the pursuit of initiatives to advance maritime education, training and research, while also aiming at preserving the environment and maritime heritage, I consider it natural that our foundation sponsor this meeting, a meeting which has established itself as an important event in the calendar of maritime gatherings of the highest level, a must-attend opportunity for people with an interest in shipping, eagerly anticipated every other year for all the high-quality contents of its program. The theme chosen for this meeting, "This World is Changing," is timely and appropriate. To be more precise, I should add that this world is, yes, changing, but in a galloping manner. Let me briefly elaborate on this, mindful of the short time Costas has asked our introductory speeches to be. Today's globalized world is characterized by a free movement of people, goods, services, and information. It is more than ever an interconnected and interdependent world in which the actions taken in one place have implications in many others, if not all over the world. Nowadays, faster than ever before. As commerce has expanded, shipping has taken on greater importance than in eras past as the major facilitator of global trade, and globalization has also given rise to new players in the maritime arena. For instance, through the process of consolidation, shipping conglomerates and alliances, as well as global terminal operators, wield increasing influence on global trade, the maritime transport sector, and shipping matters at large. We live at a time when technological changes and geopolitical developments follow each other with the speed of a train à grande vitesse that makes short stops at stations near to each other. When the search for and quest of new energy sources has no precedence in the history of mankind. When geostrategic charts in certain regions of the world, not least in the much troubled Middle East, are withdrawn in haste before even seeing the light of the day. When space technology has dissolved the mystery surrounding other planets since the dawn of history. When satellites have the potential to leave nothing undetected on our planet. And when shale oil and gas demonstrate increasingly that they have the potential to change the geopolitical dynamic, if they have not already done so. New technological developments leading through digitalization to the fourth industrial revolution nanotechnology, artificial intelligence, robotics, increasing automation, cybersecurity, renewable and alternative energy sources, they all put their mark on the era we live in. Such fundamental and radical changes could not but have an impact on shipping. An industry by international by its very nature, which is credited with servicing more than 90% of the world trade. If we use them diligently, they are capable of offering good opportunities to improve our industry's environmental performance, enhance ship safety, facilitate maritime traffic, and in final analysis, improve the efficiency and sustainable development of shipping. A Chinese saying brands fortunate those who live in interesting times. These are interesting times, and we are indeed fortunate to live in them. And here I'll bring my speech to an end. Not, however, before I put at ease the worries of those among you who I can see them wondering. Isn't he, at a meeting convened to discuss about our changing world, going to say anything about climate change? The answer is no. As I want to keep you in suspense until I and the distinguished team of panelists entertain you at the session entitled Environment and Regulations, scheduled to take place tomorrow afternoon. See you then. Thank you.
Your Eminence, Dr. Karamanlis, Your Excellencies, my lords, ladies and gentlemen, we are about to start the session which refers to 35 years. Look back, look forward, look high. And what we have here? We have 6 graduates and 1 honorary graduate. Dr. Nicholas Tsakos, president of TEN, he was here in 1985-86. He came from Colombia. He wrote a very interesting dissertation, which later on he applied it, as I'm going to mention. And he was among the ones who opened the way internationally to other ship owners to raise funds in New York. Stelios, founder, chairman of Easy Group, of EasyJet and Stelios Philanthropic Foundation, chairman of Stelios Philanthropic Foundation. He was here in 87-88. He came from LSE. I remember him when he was 13 years old, running in Philothea, and I was doing the same, and I wanted to lose some weight. And from that time, we knew that he's going to come to the course.
Before the course.
Before the course. And one more. His father wanted him to be a lawyer. But he decided not to be a lawyer. He wanted to study economics. And that's it. And you cannot persuade him if he has something in mind. Michael Tambakis, Professor Michael Tambakis, he was here in 88, 89. When he graduated, he became research assistant. He did his PhD, with us, of course. He started teaching, and he has taught generations of shipping people, energy people, and in other sectors as well. Christian Anderson, CEO of SEB in Ukraine, but his activity is much wider. He was here in 92-93. I remember he came from Palmas, from the university, and I remember also that he had been on board a number of vessels, and then when he graduated from us, he joined SEB, Skandinaviska, Enskilda Bank. That's there. A major bank of Swedish bank, well known internationally. Since then he is there. He became a banker. Now Sadan Kaptanoglu, CEO of Kaptanoglu Group, but she is president of BIMCO. She's the first woman who became president of an international organization of BIMCO, Baltic International Maritime Council. That's what BIMCO stands. And he was here in 96. The interesting thing is, up until a year ago, Nikos Tsakos was the chairman of Intertanko for 4 years. So we have two prominent graduates, who one was chairman of Intertanko and the other, she is the chairman, the president of BIMCO. I keep saying, Sadan, that this is the beginning. The beginning. She became president of an international organization. Is the beginning. Yes, it is the beginning, Sadan. We are expecting from you many other things in the future. And Eric Helberg, he was here in 2001. He was with his brother. He is a banker, investment banker, and the brother is also a banker. Same year. He is CEO of Clarksons Platou Securities. What he achieved, and that's the important thing. He created from a small unit an investment bank, securities, and he competes with international banks in providing funds to shipping companies. I mean, it's amazing what he has done. Delighted that you are here. And the honorary one is Professor Dr. Martin Stofford. Martin, join us from the very beginning. He was with the British Builders, and at the time, the chairman of British Builders was Graham Day, and he recommended him as ideal to start teaching and to assist us. So he taught here for 10 years, shipping economics and commodity trade. And next to him continued Michael Tamvakis, commodity trade. Commodity trade was for the first time taught here. And next to him, Michael Tamvakis, who continued, expanded, and the course became the unit, commodity trade and finance. Dr. Stofford, Professor Stofford is very well known. I'm not saying anything else really. But he is perhaps the most well-known shipping economist. And he holds also, he is a recipient of the Onassis Prize in shipping. So, ladies and gentlemen, Your Eminence, and Dr. Nicholas Tsakos.
Good morning, Your Eminence, Your Excellencies, Prime Minister, ladies and gentlemen, Professor, and fellow alumnus. It's a great pleasure for me to be here once again in this iconic building, the Parliament of Shipping. And since we have a Prime Minister here, you never know, we might even call an election and propose a casexit in this case. This happens on the other side of the river, of course, but we can bring it here. Visiting CAS Business School's high-tech premises last week with my son brought back many memories. My journey with the university started 30 years ago, as you kindly said, when I came straight from New York City to the London Dockyards, which was the Barbican. I guess it's like reverse immigration, as they would say. To give you an idea of what CAS did to me, I could divide my life into two periods, BC and AC, not before Christ and after Christ, before CAS and after CAS. And in order to give you some examples, these are some of the BC and AC pictures. You see that the only one who stays the same is the professor and my wife. They tend to stay still in time. The last 30 years have been definitely an exciting journey. The university inspired me and others that followed to turn my company from a traditional family business into a corporate transparent organization in the public space. At the same time, it enticed me to grow the business and pay significant dividends to the shareholders throughout the shipping cycles. And you will see this is the growth of the CAS school of thought. That's the equity markets, and that's the sums of money that have gone into shipping from the equity markets from 1987. That was my official graduation period. And a lot of this is credited to the CAS school of thought up to 2013, where I think, Eric, you did your utmost. I think you raised $2 or $3 billion that year, destroyed the market for the rest of us, but I think it sounded good at the time. This is the growth of our company. It's 15% combined for the last 26 years. It's not Apple or Microsoft, but I think for shipping terms, it will do. At the same time, we have been able to be profitable over a very long period of time. And I say that shipping, it's not a sprint, it's like a marathon. You have to be able to complete the whole process and pay the significant dividends to our shareholders, more than 700 million. And these are the various events on the stock exchange. I started by not wearing a hat when I had hair, and then I ended up wearing a hat, as you've seen in the following, in the older events. Many times during this journey, I found myself wondering what would have been better if instead of coming east from New York, I had traveled west and opened a small startup garage and called my company 10.com instead of 10 Navigation. We will never find out. That is as far as the past is concerned. Going forward, I always tell my kids the necessity of being ready for changes occurring around us. It would be a huge mistake to disregard the fluidity of the world we live in. That's why the organizers of this meeting, Professor Grammenos especially, should be congratulated for the choice of the theme of the meeting, the world is changing. In a business dimension, different circumstances ultimately affect the nature of what is profitable and what is not, and they create new challenges and vast opportunities. In the late 19th century, following the Industrial Revolution, the exploration and trade of natural resources like coal, iron ore, and oil were the fortune-making sectors. And you see here, this is in millions, not billions, in millions of dollars, that the biggest industries in 1917 was steel, oil, gas, and mining. But of course, the world changes. 100 years later, in the latter part of the 20th century, the technological revolution occurred, displacing traditional industries and creating unthinkable wealth for its founders. This is in billions of dollars now, I guess in trillions, in tech, financial services, medical, oil and gas has gone all the way down the drain, or it has lost a lot of its predominance. So this was the past, and we're living the present, but what the future holds. In the 21st century, given the current circumstances and the huge environmental challenges that we are facing, I strongly believe that the protection of the environment will be the new fortune-making frontier. I will call it the clean-up revolution. For the past 200 years, we have been profiting by dirtying the planet. It's time to benefit for cleaning it up for the next generation. In shipping, we rightly spend a lot of time and energy in reducing air and marine pollution with a target to have it, or even better, by 2050. However, we need to spare no effort into also recycling what we daily waste as a planet. On an annual basis, we produce 1.3 billion tons of garbage. To put it in perspective, it will take 7,500 dry cargo Cape sizes diamandis to store it for every year, which is more than four times the existing fleet. So please, dry cargo owners, do not take any ideas. This is not the reason we're having this discussion. As you will see, the majority of what we waste is being produced in the Western world, and a very small percentage of it is being recycled. So whether we talk about recycling or producing renewable products, whatever has the potential to make this world more sustainable has also the potential to be a promising source of wealth. If you think about it, we are the same humans that 50 years ago this year reached the surface of the moon. We must be more than capable in working together to effectively address the environmental challenges. We should aim high, as the title of this discussion is, and we should strive to recycle more than 90% of what we consume and become wealthier at the same time. Finally, profit maximization and ethical behavior can go hand to hand. In a world that produces more waste than it could ever dispose, practices that would lead to effective and environmentally friendly disposal have the potential to become one of the highest revenue-yielding sectors in the near future. We can turn trash into gold, literally. And when that happens, I can urge my fellow Casa Luminous Stelios to create easy trash, either green, easy recycling, and make all of us rich. And with that, Stelios, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm honored to be here as a member of the Grammenos fan club. I think this is what unites us more than anything else here. I have a short presentation. We're under strict instructions to keep it to 6 minutes, but don't worry, most of it is photographs, so I'll go through it quickly. The inevitable photograph with Grammenos 35 years ago and now.
We all have one.
So, actually, if I can recite his memory of Philothei, for those who live in Greece, Stivos Philotheis, he actually came to me and said, you one day will come to my course. I said, really, who are you? And the rest is history, of course. So the course was created. life was simple back then because I was the son of a Greek ship owner and I was determined to be a ship owner for the rest of my life. But something went wrong at some stage. I went to my father around 94, 95 and I said, I want to start a different business. I don't know what was the motivation. Maybe it was I wanted to prove myself to my father, which sometimes can be a very big motivation for change. My father did want me to study law. He was right, because I spend a fortune on lawyers nowadays in my different businesses. So I should have perhaps did more law in my studies, but I did economics and then I came to Grammenos. I mean, that's where I am, a Grammenos graduate. I see my sort of links with the university to fall under my giving back to society. I'm not in the shipping business anymore. I'm not particularly interested in the output of research about the shipping industry, but I do stay in touch with the university, my alma mater. So when we start thinking about repaying our debts to society, I think we should all think about our universities, our alma mater. So I came to Costas in 2006 and I said we should start a series of scholarships. So 12, 13 years later, 125 scholars have been through the City University under my scholarships, my foundation scholarships, £1.25 million. And we actually do stay in touch. So this is a real photograph from a few days ago that Costas came to our foundation's headquarters. We invite the scholars, we get to know them, we try and mentor them, and we try to encourage them to give back themselves. Because they're not the neediest people to help. I mean, they're bright people, they're, you know, relatively wealthy. But if they do well and they create big shipping companies or other businesses, hopefully they will give back to society as well. That's why scholarships, I think, is a good way. I created my own foundation. I put my name on it. It's a bit egocentric, I know, but it's about legacy. It's about how you want to be remembered. I always like to put up this photograph, talking about another photograph where we're slimmer with more hair and everything else, but that's in 1995 at 7 o'clock in the morning on the 10th of November. So in a few days' time, it will be 24 years, 10th of November. I have a habit of coming to London, I think, in November for some reason. And the first flight was from Luton to Glasgow. I always give credit to my father. At the age of 28, you cannot raise money to start an airline, especially not one that flies from Luton to Glasgow for £29. So the only person who believed in this dream was my father. And the rest is history. The company now has about 350 aircraft, flies almost 100 million people a year. The unusual thing about the way I've organized my business, I said life was a lot easier when I was at CAS. I knew I wanted to be a ship owner. Now I'm not exactly sure what business I want to be in. But I've discovered sometimes that the business of making money is probably the best business. So you have to learn to change and move and adapt according to the circumstances. But the way I've organized my business is when I floated the companies, EasyJet and later Easy Hotel and some of the others, I kept the ownership of the name. So I have an income stream, a predictable income stream. Every time you fly EasyJet, 0.25% comes into my own company, which I use to fund charitable giving and other resources, other projects, because it's predictable, it's regular, it's less volatile than bottom line profits. We started another project with CAS now, another Costas. I don't know if the other Costas Andriopoulos is in this room, but we're going to run a competition to encourage CAS students and CAS alumni to start a business under the Easy brand. So I'm looking forward to this new venture, if you like, with the City University. And I hope that if there are any alumni in the group here today that want to start a business under the Easy brand, you're going to let me know. And we pay prizes as well and invest in them. Two, 3 minutes quickly about my foundation. The mission statement is to give close to home. I mean, there are bigger fortunes than mine that go and solve problems, global problems, you know, go to the middle of Africa to help the neediest in the world. I stay close to home. So the poor little Cypriot boy, my late father, started in Cyprus, went to Greece, built a a shipping empire, went to London, his children were educated there, had an office there, and then when he made enough money, he moved to Monaco. So these are the four countries we focus in. We now put bricks and mortar into the foundation, the idea that this is a foundation for the long term. We have the building on the left is in Thurlow Square in South Kensington in London, and it's available to other charities and good causes to hold events there, fundraising events. We do a number of CAS events there with Costas, equivalent building in Cyprus, in Monaco, and in Greece. I give money to disabled entrepreneurs. Again, the theme of entrepreneurship, encouraging people to start their own business. People with a disability have a problem finding a job. So creating your own business might be a solution. How many of you have been to Cyprus? Show of hands, just to... Good, more than I thought, but excellent. It's a great shipping center. But
South Cyprus.
Well, I mean, that's the point. I mean, if someone landed from Mars, didn't know much about Earth, and they told that Martian, here is an island, about a million people, and it has a Greek Cypriot side, a Turkish Cypriot side. It has the green zone in the middle, which is a no man's land, controlled by the United Nations. You know, there are not many places in the world that look like that. And let's not forget the British sovereign bases. When the British gave independence to Cyprus in 1960, they kept a bit of the island for themselves. So it's a very complicated island. I mean, it's prosperous now, but it's a bit like Berlin, it's a bit like Korea. The militarized zone in the middle and everything else. So my giving back project for the last 11 years is to get the two communities to work together. So we literally every year pay about €500,000 to Greek Cypriots and Turkish Cypriots that do something jointly. Cooperate. It started in business, but now it's all walks of life. Now, this is the most heartbreaking, if you like, project I have in giving back. Again, around Greece and Cyprus, but the situation in Athens is becoming very dramatic. We started when the economic crisis started to help people with food. Enough calories to live another day. It usually takes the form of a snack, industrially produced snack that you would find in a periptero for a euro. And we used to give about 200,000, we had 200,000 visitors in a month, and in the last 2 months it's gone up to 350,000 visitors in a month. Most of the growth, most of the increase in demand is actually in the middle of Athens. This photograph is in number 10 of Evripidou Street in the middle of Athens, and about 10,000 people every day turn up there looking for just enough food to survive another day. Now, the Greeks, the Athenians, if you like, who go, are a small percentage of that and declining. Although we never ask the question, our mission is to give without discrimination, and that's why we're helping all these people now. But it is clear to me that there is a issue with recent migrants in Athens at the moment. And, you know, I'm not a politician, I don't know how to solve the problem, but, you know, if you're looking for a barometer, just go to Evripidou Street and stand in and see the line, and you'll understand what is going on. Our purpose, our mission is to help them. We're all humans, synanthropy, but there is an issue in the last couple of months. Something has changed. I joined the club. I know that many of you have yachts and belong to yacht clubs and other clubs. I joined the club of philanthropists. So it's a club that was started by Bill Gates and Warren Buffett in 2010. The pledge, the promise, if you like, is that we will give half our fortune to a good cause. It doesn't have to be today, and Bill Gates does not get the money. Don't get the wrong idea. It is not about giving your money to Bill Gates. He doesn't need my money. This is about, normally, we are about 200 of us in this club. Normally, each one of us would set up a foundation and give by will, in the end, as an endowment, half the fortune to continue to do good for the long term. I'll put up a Greek word here. Thankfully, many people in the audience can read it directly. In English, you would loosely translate it as legacy, or crudely, it's reputation after death. So how would people remember you after you leave from this world? So I believe that although people will remember me as the founder of EasyJet, the second thing they will remember about is that I gave back to society and I repaid my debt. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. I spent most of my life using graphs and talking a lot, so today it's an opportunity to do neither. Your Eminence, Dr. Karamanlis, Professor, Your Excellencies, my lords, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great privilege to stand on this podium today. It's a great joy, most of all, to see so many familiar faces, but also a stark reminder that I am here by virtue of being older. Most of the hair is gone, the rest is white. Professor put a difficult task to look at this looking back and forward and then looking high. So starting with the looking back, I have been at the center for this 31 of the 35 years we're celebrating today. I was a student on the fifth anniversary, which we, at the time, we helped at the Baltic Exchange with several very memorable personalities, and have seen through today 30 cohorts of students, so that 30 keeps reappearing. My three closest and dearest friends come from the very first five cohorts of this course. So looking back means for me friendship, common purpose, and a lot of fun, especially when being students. Now, looking forward, I was fortunate to be at the beginning of the professional journeys of many, many graduates, and this gives me a sense of looking forward in their lives as I cross their timelines every time as our paths meet, in meetings like this, among other. With every cohort, I cannot help but wonder where these young women and men will be from 5 or 10 years from now, and how they will have changed professionally and personally. And this brings me to the theme of this conference, which is change and the challenge of a changing world. Although change means different things to many people, we cannot help but notice climate change, its alarming proximity, and how it is becoming a climate emergency post-haste. The current and future student cohorts will be fraught with the task of plotting their path in a much more complex world, while also trying to bring change to the business models of the industries they will change or they will join. So looking forward for me means joy for the success of our graduates and anticipation for the triumphs of the next generation. Looking high is the toughest of the three meanings, I guess, ideas we seek this morning. One can read this as ambition, perseverance, aiming for high achievement, striving for success. And I do urge you all to look high. As Seneca stated once, if a man knows not to which port he sails, no wind is favorable. So you need a sense of purpose. But it also means taking the time to look low and consider the consequences of our actions on others. And I will finish with another writer, Ralph Waldo Emerson. To know even one life has breathed easier because you have lived. This is to have succeeded. And I call upon my fellow alumnus, Christian Anderson. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody. It's great to be here, and I'm very honored to be here. I have been participating in a few of these events as well during the years, and it's always a great pleasure to come here and to meet old friends. When I got this topic, I have to admit I had no clue what I should speak about. But I, after a while and after thinking, I decided to make some comments on two areas. One a little bit about the world and how the world economy looks, and the other on communications, especially telephone communications or communication technology. Because I find that very interesting. We, as you probably know, as we are a Swedish bank, we have one of the big network developers as one of our main clients, and we have a lot of very interesting discussions with this company about the future. How I First, if we look back 35 years, that's fairly easy. I mean, I was 22 years old. I was studying at university to become a master mariner. The world was very much, in terms of economy, dominated by United States and Europe. Japan was also the second largest economy in the world. China and these countries, everybody, as I remember, were talking about this China, but it's like something that will come in the future. Everybody knows that China was a huge country, but it hadn't really happened. And at 85, it was still not a very big share of the world economy. Communication, also interesting to look at 35 years ago. I think everybody remember fax, telex. Computers started to come. We didn't have it in university when I studied in early 80s. We had it in one room that was locked, and you had certain lessons in there. I remember the teacher opened the door because it was so valuable equipment in his room. But really, the computers looked like on the pictures here. I mean, you couldn't do very much with them. Same with communication, mobile telephones. I mean, they were heavy. They were extremely expensive, but they started to come, and then the evolution became quite quickly. I just read for interest that in 85, Vodafone sold a transportable phone here in UK. The weight was 4.7 kilos, and the price in today's money value was 4,600 pounds. So you can imagine what evolution we have had in this area. And the same with telephone booths. I mean, you saw these booths everywhere, basically, in cities and so on. And you went in there and you put in coins and you made calls. Now, if we try to look 35 years ahead, first you see a rough, the statistics here varies a little bit. I think this is from the IMF that I've used on the world GDP. This is how it looks today, or last year. China has changed. I mean, now we're no longer talking about it. China is definitely a major economy, and maybe the most major coming up. US and Europe is still there, and looking 35 years ahead, I mean, it's very hard to foresee, but of course, I think it's not unreasonable to expect India, United States, and China to be the three dominant still. I mean, they are both, all three of them are countries with very large populations, very strong economies. And I think it's more a question of how big the shares of these three will be. And Europe maybe will be there as well, maybe a little bit smaller, but if they manage to stick together, we will see. The percentages is more hard to predict. When it comes to communication, I want to mention especially two areas. One is hologram communication or holographic communication, and the other one is more a little bit far in the distance. It's a more widely used of artificial intelligence. The holographic communication, I mean, this technology is already here with the 5G networks that has been or is being rolling out. What this makes is that it's possible to and you see the pictures, the two pictures on top here, it will be possible to have a much more realistic meetings by phone, where you will basically see the person in the room as a projected picture, a little bit like you have seen in films, in Star Wars, etc. And the technology, as I mentioned, it is here. It's possible to do this already today. It's more a matter of how to refine this technology and to get down in price of this technology. But when you speak to these companies, like when I speak to Ericsson and so on, I mean, they expect this to be very widely used, maybe in the period from 5 to 10 years. And what it will do is probably going to lead to that we travel a lot less, because they are convinced, at least, that business will adopt this new technology very quickly. And then there will be less need of of traveling, and that is also very much related to environment and so on. The other thing that comes later is a more systemized and refined use of artificial intelligence. First of all, in 35 years, or actually a lot earlier than that, it's very likely that barriers will be heavily reduced when it comes to languages, for example, by combination of artificial intelligence. When you speak on the phone, you can speak your own language, and it will be in the receiver's language when he listens to you. I mean, this will come. It's 100% sure. Other things that is almost a little bit more scary, I think at least, is that the widely use of artificial intelligence, I mean, it will automize all mechanical tasks, basically, and all repetitive tasks. And it will come very close to something that can be likened like decision making. Basically, it will be up to the humans to allow or not that decisions are taken by these machines. But I think most realistically, and the industry also thinks, that the decisions will still be made by humans, because in the decisions it's a lot of emotion still, and this will be very hard to transfer to machines. But all the preparations of a decision base will be put to the machine. They will do it much better. All analysis will be done by machines. They will do that much, much better as well. So in the decision making, the human's roles will be when emotions are involved, and they always involve that as part of the decision making. I think possibilities are enormous in this area, and it's very fascinating to speak to these people who are in this industry and how they see these things coming. And a lot of this technology will come with this 5G, because that is a very big change. Especially when we're talking about these holographic communications. And there is also thoughts that when you speak on the telephone, you, in the future, you will be able to see holograms also from the telephone of the person you're speaking to. I mean, it sounds like very, very scientific and maybe strange today, but technology is there. It's more cost and to refine this technology. This was two areas I wanted to give you some thoughts about. Thank you very much.
Your Excellencies, Prime Minister, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. 35 years ago, Professor Costas Grammenos established the International Center for Shipping, Trade and Finance. In 1984, MSC Shipping, Trade and Finance was introduced. The moment I think about 1984, I remember the famous Orwell novel of 1984, where Orwell tried to predict his version of the future. That was a novel written 75 years ago. In real time in 1984, a young professor predicted the future needs of maritime industry, formed MSC Shipping, Trade and Finance, and looking today, we all know that he was right in every aspect, and he was able to create his own prediction. Dear professor, we are all appreciated. Your vision, your hard work, thank you so much. Thank you. And let me. Ladies and gentlemen, I have some questions for you. Are you an optimist or a pessimist? Is the future bright or dark? In the novel 1984, the future is dark. There is a perpetual war. Truth, privacy, and freedom no longer exist. As it turns out, we didn't need a government to force us to share everything about ourselves with anyone who would listen. We communicate every aspect of our life, our health, our family relations, our shopping habits, and our personal opinions. Some governments seem, however, to have embraced the fake news label for any version of the truth they don't particularly like. The famous science fiction writer Isaac Asimov was asked in 1983 to predict what 2019 would look like. He said three major points would stand out: nuclear war, computerization, space utilization. Asimov was an optimist and saw a bright future. He assumed we would avoid nuclear war, and so far he has been right. He saw that computers and automation would change the way we worked, and that everyone who could would learn computer skills. If Elon Musk and others achieve their dreams, we will be close to what Asimov imagined we would do with space, like transfer solar energy to the Earth via satellites or mining the moon. Because he was an optimist, he thought the pressure on our planet from pollution and a rapidly growing population will be reduced, eliminated by advance in technology. On this, he was wrong. It is difficult to predict the future. Sometimes it is difficult to look high if you don't predict. But however, I will do my best, and I will try to look ahead, to look into our future based on what I see today. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change was established in 1988. Before then, there was no significant discussion on climate change. Harvard University professor Michael McElroy said back then that the alternative to acting now was close our eyes, hope for the best, and pay the cost when the bill comes due. I think the bill is coming due, and I think the young generations had enough. Young generations have a global perspective on the world, and they can see their parents and grandparents haven't done enough to stop the use of fossil fuels and degradation of the planet. So where does shipping stand in this? You might think that I will begin to talk about the goals and the regulations, about emission levels 2030, the new goals in 2050, the different percentages, whether or not LNG is the fuel for the future. I won't be talking about them. Shipping has been the servant of the trade for centuries. Trade has generated wealth and growth, and yet today, I believe we stand at the brink of a massive global change that will affect our industry deeply. We will see consumers globally demand greener solutions, which has already pushed politicians in France, in the UK, to go carbon neutral by 2050. I am not sure that will be quick enough for the millennials and Generation Z. And I think we will see more and more radical requirements in the next few years. I hope that all these bright young minds entering our schools and universities with their minds bent on climate change also lead to an acceleration of technological change towards the sustainable solutions. In any case, we must embrace the change and create our future together, or a new order will be imposed on us by these forces of change. It is imperative the shipping embrace change, adapt and work together. We need to work together on research and stop getting lost in discussions about additional cost. The bill is coming due. We all have to pay it. Now we must imagine and build ships powered by zero emission energy sources. We must create energy efficient ports, and perhaps at some point in the not too distant future, our ships will become part of a circular economy, and everything is recycled back into the new ships and productions. Now, you all might be thinking, has Shadan become a romantic futurist? No, ladies and gentlemen, I am no romantic or futurist. On the contrary, I believe I see the change, I see the shift. And in my mind, there is only one question. How can ship owners be a leading force in this change? Because if we are not the leaders, we simply become pawns in the zero emission future. The decision is yours. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Your Eminence, Prime Minister, dear Professor, thank you very much for your very kind invitation. I'll be quick, don't worry. I only have four slides that I would like to share with you, or rather discussion points, I would say, to hopefully set the stage for discussions we're having the next 3 days. And they're not about myself. Unfortunately, I have no pictures about myself. They're more about the market. The shipping market, which I must say I've been privileged to be a part of this past 20 years. And as opposed to what many environmentalists probably say, the shipping industry is really important. It is today by far the most economical and environmentally friendly to transport goods around the world. And we need them to move around the world to take people out of poverty. The industry is doing a lot, I think, something that should have been placed on other hands to help the environment, but we're definitely doing our part. So, when looking back at the markets, I tried to look back as far as I could find data. And obviously, being part of Clarkson's, we can dig back in the archives, and we've been through a downturn, kind of, I would say, rather a dismal downturn the last 10 years. I even have to take out my old book, Martin, Maritime Economics, which was very helpful. And the as far as back as you could that I could go to find a down market was in 1884. And interestingly enough, the parameters that led to that downturn more than 135 years ago, you know, was very similar to what we've seen the last 10 years. So, overproduction of tonnage, banks lending out way too much cash, owners really eager, obviously, to, I guess, expand and grow their fleets, and trade that, in a way, contracted a bit. And also, a technological shift in that environment from sailing ships to steamships. And it ended up, luckily, with a, you know, boom after that. So, when I look, I guess, forward 125 years, in 2010, which in a way, or nine, was a pivotal point that we've experienced with a bit of distress. First of all, banks. Bank lending peaked in 2008-09. Close to $500 billion were lent out. Ordering was massive. We had huge order books in most segments, and leading obviously to very high supply growth and very challenging markets. If we now look forward, and the key today, I think, is obviously the supply side. People, we have to worry about demand, but it's not a demand story, it's a supply story. Bank financing is significantly less available. It's been reduced by more than $100 billion the last 10 years. Some of you might say, well, hang on, Eric, what about Chinese leasing? Well, looked into that. So if you look in 2015, Chinese leasing to the large shipping segments was $7 billion. In 16, it was $12 billion. In 17, it was $12 billion again. So it's important, but definitely not enough to kind of close that gap. At the same time, the fleet's grown from 1.3 billion deadweight to close to 2 billion deadweight. So there's definitely something that needs to be gapped. Yard capacity, it's down, and it's down to stay. Some of you might argue, well, you know, China will always build, maybe, but the Chinese are economically smart. They're not putting money into industries that are loss-making. There are other parts of the economy where they can invest and get people employed without losing money. And the Korean government lost $25 billion in DSME alone. So yard capacity, again, for yards taking orders, down from more than 500 10 years ago to less than 50 as of last year. And there's also, obviously, a disruption going on. disruption. You might, you know, say that the environmental pressure we're seeing is obviously leading to a lot of discussion on what is the right technology for the future. That concern or that lack of knowledge of what it's actually going to be is obviously leading to less ordering, and I think that we will continue to see less ordering going forward. And the private equity that obviously poured into the industry 5 years ago are more looking at exiting and are not long-term players in the industry anymore. So when I briefly then look at how the capital markets look, which have been historically important and are going to be more important going forward, you know, 13 and 14 were active years, or 5 years ago are active years. Since then, it's been a downward trend following the market. We've obviously had alternative sources. I mentioned Chinese leasing and some of them, and bonds have obviously paid a major source. But the focus of the day is consolidation and M&A, and we're seeing it in quite a big degree, I would argue. And why aren't we, or why do I not expect to see a lot of aggressive ordering, Nick, in terms of new builds, etc.? Because you guys have big fleets. I mean, you've got, what, 64 ships? Scorpio at the time had 6, they have 148. DHT had 7, they now have 27 VLCCs. So there are large companies today that investors can invest in. They're more than $2 billion market cap companies, so they're investable. So I don't see any frenzy, new build frenzy going on in the future. So it looks good. It looks actually to go high and higher. So to wrap it up, bank financing is less available. Yard capacity is down. There's more focus on consolidation rather than adding new capacity. And the fundamentals, I believe, haven't looked as bright for quite a long time, and I hope you agree, Martin, because you're the true expert, so the floor is yours. Thank you very much.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, Costas dignitaries. As a non-guardian on this panel, Costas, I'm very honoured to be here. And it's some of you who I taught, it was back in the 80s, might remember I used to stagger in at 5 o'clock, somewhat dishevelled, and had to teach you till 8 o'clock. It was unbelievable. And I think I experimented with many different techniques, and somebody reminded me that one was I used to ask questions at the end. After we'd had a break, I would ask some questions. And apparently, I used to threaten anyone who couldn't answer the question with having to sing a song. And the Greeks on the back row really hated this. I'm not sure it lasted very long, but it was a little bit of the techniques which I learnt in this heart of school knocks, how to cope with it. And I think, Costas, it's been a great marathon for 35 years, as Nikos says. And I congratulate you on having guided the whole thing through such a wonderful period, and to see all of you gathered here together, I think it just shows what can be done if you set your sights on a target and you work towards it. I think at the moment we have a new marathon starting. Many of the speakers have mentioned it. I'm not going to talk about it, because if you want to know what I think, you'll have to come to the last session at 5 o'clock tomorrow, where we're going to go from 5 to 7 o'clock. And my
sing songs after.
Definitely, yes, yes. Whoever sings song, we probably need one actually. And but I do think that it's very inspiring, without sort of picking out anyone. I think Nikos and Stelios have given us a wonderful example of what can happen if you really do apply yourself, even if you do get a few bob from your father, as they say, you know. And I think that the next marathon is going to be a tough one, and we ought to be ready for it. Don't think you and I are going to be there at the end, Costas, but the ground set. On that, thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
Dear guests, this is on behalf of the alumni of the 2005 cohort. They've prepared a wonderful present to the school and to the professor. And I was asked to unveil it, although there was some, you had some peek during the previous presentation. And I have also been asked to find an appropriate space within the school to place it. So let's unveil it officially now, and then I'll read you.
Wow.
So this piece is by renowned Russian painter Alan Kalmanov. It's just a small sign of appreciation from this cohort. And let me say a few things that they wanted me to say, so I'm quoting them. Over and above the professor's outstanding academic knowledge and professional abilities, we value his far-reaching natural wisdom, inexhaustible enthusiasm and life energy that can motivate even the youngest and most dynamic of us to new achievements. As children are never able to repay all the good deeds we receive from parents, the same way we believe that as alumni of the center, we will not be able to pay you back for all you have done and continue doing for us. By organizing events such as this one and by driving the center to new heights and of quality and recognitions within the industry. Although it was not easy, this painting attempts to capture the unending life energy, drive, and inspirational wisdom that you have and share with all of us, Professor. We hope that by placing it in the school, we give everyone the opportunity to feel the power of smile and feel the joy by simply looking at it. So a big thank to the graduates from 2005 for their generosity, of course, and a huge thank to Professor, a true inspiration for all of us. Thank you.
And on top of this, the professor had to stay still for more than 1 minute to get this done. So that's another big
It is impressive because I didn't have any standing. I mean, I suppose it is from photographs and from films. I mean, the guy is not this, the other guy, the painter. He's top class.
And the model is still alive.
I thank you so very much. Really, I do appreciate it. It's very moving, and I really thank all the graduates for this. A very warm welcome to you, Dr. Karamalis. May I say that we are truly honored and delighted by your presence here. This is the first celebratory event for our 35th year anniversary. Similar events in Europe, the Far East, and New York will follow in 2020 and 2021. We will not be celebrating the 35th anniversary, but we'll continue. The first one is going to take place in Hamburg, and it's going to be sponsored by Peter Dule Group. We had the same thing in 2015.
When is that?
End of June. It's going to be on a Saturday. And it was on a Saturday. We were 450 people there.
And Sunday to get the hangover out.
But it was really great from every point. I want to thank very much the Maria Tsakos Foundation and the chairman, Sir Evthymios, and Nicholas Tsakos, and his father, Captain Panagiotis, for sponsoring the biennial meetings, at least the five, if not six, biennial meetings. Thank you so much. Professor Volpin, Paolo, I thank you so very much for your exceedingly kind and complimentary comments, as I thank the comments that were made by the graduates who produced this. In reply, I can only say that the establishment of our center happened here in the City of London, a great place. At City, University of London and its Cass Business School, in cooperation with my colleagues, our students, our graduates, and our friends. And I thank very much the ones who have organized this, and I mean Marlene Stapleton, and then today, Mariam Ragovskaya, and certainly, I mean, the one who has been very central on this is Christy Lucio. She spent enormous time. I was blessed to have very, very good assistant, very, very good assistant. And I don't know whether my another PA, Gladys Paris, is here. No. Oh, you're there. All right. She was for 26 years my PA. And and for 56 years, with the City University, 56 years. Ladies and gentlemen, you cannot achieve such things without highly qualified and dedicated staff. This is the small unit of the academics and the two PAs. You are going to see them here, but we have additionally colleagues from our finance and management faculty who teach, and also we have visiting lecturers. There are certain requirements in order to succeed in new creations. The innovative idea, your colleagues and friends whom you trust and work with, and also a lot of work, a lot of work. I often say to my students that to become successful, apart from being intelligent, then everybody is intelligent nowadays at the university, and apart from having ideas, then very many may have ideas. You also need three things. How many of you are graduates? May I see hands? Oh, not bad. Not bad. So, you need three things. The first one is to work hard. The second one? That's one. And the third one? What? Exactly. The fact that a new day may start at 5 p.m. can make the difference. Dr. Karamelis, Your Excellencies, my lords, ladies and gentlemen. The story, there is always a story, started 35 years ago with a lunch I had with the then newly appointed dean of the City University Business School, Professor Brian Griffiths. And now Lord Griffiths at Will Bentley's restaurant on Bishopsgate on 29th of March 1982. You can find the details in the timeline that we have. There are a lot of details on this. That's exactly that thing, the timeline, yeah. At the time, the worst shipping crisis of the 20th century had begun following the two oil shocks in 1973 and 1979. The governments of industrial countries had taken fiscal and monetary measures to curb the high rate of inflation, while the non-oil producing countries were suffering from the high price of oil and the substantial decrease in their exports. It was also the period of the world debt crisis, when banks were facing bleak prospects as non-performing loans, including those of shipping, had impacted upon the financial results and their strategy policies. Shipping banks were considering scenarios of substantially decreasing their exposure in shipping or abandoning altogether the shipping industry. Does this remind you something? That was the environment in the City of London when I met with Brian. We discussed his plans regarding the further development of the business school, my plans, and how these could be combined. And the meeting concluded with an invitation extended by Brian to me to visit the school. He wrote the address and instructions on the card of the restaurant. Again, please look at the timeline. We decided to create the center and the new program. From the very first day, the center became the first self-finance center and the first self-finance postgraduate course in the entire United Kingdom. For the first, very first day, we defined with rigidity the center's raison d'etre: excellence in teaching, in research, in dialogue. From the very first day, we made theory and practice an axiom, the importance of which is underlined by the center's ongoing drive to maintain a strong relationship with businesses in the City of London and other international cities. We were, in fact, the first to bring the City of London into our school and the first to take the school into the City of London. If I'm cheeky, do allow me. It's 35 years I'm discussing now, and I have an age that I can say I cannot mince my words. As early of 1985, we introduced the spherical or global approach as a new method for analysis in shipping and more generally international business, but mainly in shipping. This approach dictates that business decisions will be based on the microcosm of the company, that is to say, its management, its finances, its operations, and at the same time, on the external parameters, such as world industrial production, seaborne trade, commodities, interest rates, exchange rates, and finance sources. A new approach was introduced with the creation of our innovative MSc in Shipping, Trade and Finance and the two other courses that followed later, Energy Trade and Finance, Transport Trade and Finance. The creation of these new courses was an answer to the ever-changing business world and to structural changes in shipping, finance, and more generally in international business. We believe that our students had to be well prepared with certainty to face the approach in new business world. Within this framework, we offer modules which appear uniquely at university level. Examples include shipping finance and commodity trade. This new approach, ladies and gentlemen, was very different from other universities which were offering courses in maritime studies, for instance. However, it was a real pleasure to see universities in Europe and elsewhere follow in our steps, albeit for some a couple of decades later. Research was a more complicated issue. We wanted to start from scratch and create our own research staff from the benches of our classes or from our own PhD students. Originally, it was based on my research of 1970s in bank finance, bank shipping finance, which had been adopted by all major international banks in the 1980s and was also used as our teaching material on the subject. Then we turn our attention, and again we were the first, on capital markets as a source of finance for shipping. I can also proudly say that through our research, our teaching, our keynote speeches at various major events worldwide, we contributed in a substantial way in the utilization of capital markets by shipping companies. Finally, in the last 20 years, our attention also turned from research viewpoint to risk management in shipping, commodity trade, and energy, and we are thriving. All these guys are involved with this. Dialogue, ladies and gentlemen, was another objective to be achieved. From the beginning, leaders of the City of London and other international cities, governmental representatives and academics became engaged in continuous dialogue, either in lecture rooms or the school's auditorium, through speeches, seminars, debates and conferences. On many occasions, students wrote their dissertation at the offices of various companies. Apart from the creative dialogue between the business, the academics, and the policymakers under our roof, the center's additional aim was to expose our students to the practice and realities of the real world. Over the 35-year period, we have organized 9 biennials, 12 conferences, 19 Piraeus meetings, 4 Athens triennials, 5 symposia, 30 seminars, 10 public lectures, and well over 350 speeches and presentations where very many business executives. In 2009, an important development took place. The Onassis Foundation, in cooperation with our center, our school, our university, and the City of London, sponsored the Onassis Prizes in shipping, in international trade, and finance, each of them $200,000 value. The Onassis Prizes are granted every 3 years to international leading academics who have had substantial impact on their own field. I have, and we have in the City of London, no doubt that the Onassis Prizes will be in the near future the most important recognition in these 3 academic areas worldwide. Ladies and gentlemen, let me refer briefly to the theme of our 9th biennial meeting, The World is Changing. 2 of the main drivers for change are technology and environment. Everything I knew in our business world is under minor or major change. Some of the issues are going to be presented and discussed during these 3 years. I do thank very warmly the chairman, the presenters, the discussants, and all participants to our biennial meeting. I'm grateful to them. As center by looking ahead, have become to teach some totally new units which are offered as electives, such as FinTech, financial technology, in shipping, energy, trade and finance, taught by George Politis, visiting lecturer to the center, and one of us, that is to say a graduate. Big data in commercial shipping and trading, a course taught during the last 2 years and based on research produced by the highly qualified staff of Signal Group, which has been created by Ioannis Martinos. Shipping company management, another course unit. In this, the student is taught how the shipping company is organized and operates. It familiarizes with strategic and operational framework, standards and processes, and finally, will be able the student to adopt integrated thinking. This is taught by Michael Fostiropoulos. He is one of us, and his team from his group, Almi Tankers. Business analytics for energy, shipping, and finance. This unit will be produced and taught in cooperation from next year with the Ionassis Group. Our academic staff are currently conducting research in these rapidly developing fields. We often cooperate with our graduates, 3,900 of them, who come from 160 countries and have become bankers, shipowners, executives of shipping companies, ship brokers, stock brokers, traders, or executives of manufacturing or oil companies, and lawyers. For all of us, our graduates are simply our students who are high flyers. They look ahead and they look high. And as we say here, he or she is one of us. But ultimately, they are most precious products, our students. Ladies and gentlemen, everything we achieved was based on new ideas, hard work, very hard work, dedication, friendship, and trust. The school and the university were and are able to approve the new ideas and nurture them. We have applied all the way the principle of meritocracy, axiokratia in ancient Greek, a principle that it is an axiom in our school and the City of London. Finally, we have always put the center, our school, and the university above us, above our ego, above our personal interests. The 35 years have been a great journey which continues and will continue. When the captain steps down in a few years, the vessel will be run by first-class dedicated officers and a crew of over 4,000 graduates. The richness of knowledge, experience, and relevance that the voyage offers will remain exceedingly high and global. Thank you for your attention. Not bad, eh? The photos. Very photogenic, the guys.
You should hire some Greeks sometime, won't you?
Did you notice? Meritocracy. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now time to call upon Dr. Costas Grammenos to give the keynote speech. And may I say that we are truly honored and delighted by your presence, or should I say, by your return to CAS. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Costas Grammenos is a leading European statesman who has a close relationship with CAS Business School and City University of London. Dr. Grammenos spoke here for the first time in February 2003 Actually, it was the first function in the new school. As a leader of the opposition, and returned in 2004 as Prime Minister, and again in 2007. In addition, he was the keynote speaker at the two first Athens Triennial Meetings. Dr. Karamanlis, we are extremely honored and delighted by your return to Kass Business School after 12 years. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Costas Grammenos.
Professor Grammenos, distinguished guests and speakers, ladies and gentlemen. It is a privilege to speak at the Costas Grammenos Center for Shipping, Trade and Finance, the lifelong achievement of Professor Grammenos. Research and teaching on the interrelationship between shipping, trade and finance was a very critical novelty, turning the center into a pioneer in the field. Under his inspired leadership, the center grew to become a leading institution globally. Costa, particularly for Greece, the world's first shipping power, this is a great service, and we are all grateful and thank you for that. Ladies and gentlemen, shipping, trade and finance do not operate in a vacuum. Today, as we celebrate the 35 years journey of the center, inevitably, we contemplate the global challenges ahead. That is, the global context in which we are called to operate today and in the future. As we look around, it is clear that we are faced with a world far less predictable than ever in the recent past. We have entered a phase of increasing uncertainty. Realignment of forces, changes in behaviors, or transformation of powers are frequent, and they make the international scene much more volatile than in any other phase after the Second World War. Things are now happening that would have been unthinkable only a few years ago. Look at Brexit. It hasn't been long since it would be difficult to envisage the European Union without the UK, and the UK not being part of the European Union. The adventures for concluding Brexit during the previous months, as we have all followed, have already demonstrated the hardships of the overall endeavor. Future developments are at this moment highly uncertain. My sincere hope is that whatever the outcome, strong ties and close cooperation between the UK and the European Union will prevail to the benefit of all parties. My country, Greece, has also been for almost a decade in the midst of a painful experience due to the economic crisis. An experience that put a lot of strain on the country and our people. The new government, however, shows the willingness to act swiftly and boldly, particularly as reforms and the creation of an investment-friendly environment is concerned, thus offering a realistic perspective of a more optimistic future. Ladies and gentlemen, despite the horrific images emitted so often in our TV screens concerning violent acts on various levels, the truth is quite different. Less people die today from human violence than probably ever before. It is true that humanity has avoided a major conflict in the decades following the Second World War. Nevertheless, states today increasingly sub-state actors as well, still intend to use power politics to achieve their ends. These may sound commonplace, having been actually and accurately formulated by Thucydides 2,500 years ago. But the evolution of the international system during these starting years of the 21st century poses a series of new, highly demanding challenges. Both the bipolar world of the Cold War years and the hegemony of the sole superpowers in the years following the collapse of the Soviet bloc offered a considerable degree of stability. Surely the world was not an idyllic paradise. Clashes, peripheral wars, tensions were there, but the system was more or less stable. Now this factor is changing rapidly and possibly profoundly. A new multipolar world is emerging. Certainly, the United States still is the leading power in the world, but it finds it more and more difficult to impose its will, as proven so often in recent years. Coupled by the dismaying weakness of the European Union to assume an international role commensurate to its real capacity, this puts the West in a gradually awkward position. Certainly, it leaves growing room for other actors to try to fill the gap, or at least exploit the vacuum. China, Russia, but also lesser actors such as Iran, Turkey, and others exhibit an ever-growing mobility in their effort to promote their interests and influence in their regions. In other words, we are entering a phase of relative multipolarity, enhanced unpredictability, and rising uncertainty. The broader Middle East and Northern Africa in the last decade offer ample examples of that. The picture becomes more confused and risky if combined with recent developments that deteriorate the prospects furthermore. The Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty has collapsed. Now, only one major bilateral agreement, the new START agreement, limits the United States and Russian nuclear arsenals. A new arms race looks likely. The United States' withdrawal from the Iran nuclear deal finally led to Iran's announcement of an uranium enrichment increase beyond the agreed limit. Talks with North Korea did not yield any substantive progress towards denuclearization. Soon, competition with China will no longer be limited to trade or technology. The People's Liberation Army's advances will eventually allow it to compete for hegemony in Asia and possibly beyond. Turkey's unilateral military action in Syria will further undermine the stability of the whole region and jeopardize the progress achieved to defeat ISIS. Combined with its bullying approach vis-à-vis Cyprus, Turkey shows that it is steadily becoming a revisionist country, in other words, a possible troublemaker in the broader region. Its behavior in the Aegean further reinforces this perception. Terrorism has transformed itself formidably. Ladies and gentlemen, the very fact that extreme terrorists created their own quote-unquote state, the Islamic State, was thought as unthinkable. And although ISIS has almost been defeated, there remains a significant threat to international security. At the same time, Islamic terrorism is no longer just an external threat. It is believed until recently that it was a threat somewhere beyond the realm of Western societies. But it has been transferred within our cities. Internal and external security are increasingly intertwined and require appropriate responses. A new chapter in international security challenges opens with cyber and hybrid threats, a still unclear landscape of what the future may nurture. Within seconds, a well-prepared cyber attack could paralyze the entire power network of any advanced country, destroy flight control centers, provoke major industrial accidents in nuclear or chemical installations, break down communication systems of police, intelligence, and armed forces, and delete trillions of dollars or euros without any trace. Now, this is a poisonous weapon in the hands both of state and non-state actors. Finally, not only relevant to this conference, but also crucial in the context of modern international security challenges, is maritime security. Suffice it to stress here that freedom of navigation is very critical, since, as most of you know better than me in this conference, 90% of the world trade is carried by ships. Terrorism, piracy, and regional conflicts pose serious threats to free and secure access to the seas nowadays. The recent incidents in the Straits of Hormuz are a case in point. In addition, technological advances now allow for new opportunities to emerge related to the exploitation of various maritime resources. As a consequence, today, the majority of states extends or wishes to extend their exclusive economic zone up to 200 nautical miles, and competition for scarce resources already causes conflicts at sea. Ladies and gentlemen, trade wars is another factor of great uncertainty. Trade wars are not new in history. Historically, they even escalated to full conflict between states, control over the seas and trade routes, including attacks on merchant shipping. But our recent history has not experienced a trade war, or at least a full-out trade war, where raw materials and various products on the one hand, and the largest global economies on the other, are involved. Moreover, the ramifications could be much broader than that. For the moment, those countries affected by the US tariffs are reacting proportionally and the effects of this war have been, relatively speaking, under control. Nevertheless, there is growing concern that the situation could exacerbate. The most extreme scenario is that if an all-out trade war erupts and the United States leaves the World Trade Organization, the slowdown in world trade could be aggravated to the extent that could even signal the beginning of the end of globalization. Trade integration, which started after the Second World War, reached its peak in the period 1990 up to 2008. Since then, trade has slowed, while protectionism has been on the rise. At the same time, public support for globalization has declined, at least on both sides of the Atlantic. In Europe, Euroscepticism has challenged the principles of freedom of movement and economic integration. And in the United States, the benefits of free trade have been openly called into question. Having said that, we've got to remember that international trade has strongly stimulated economic growth. Trade liberalization has been a key factor driving global prosperity. Trade integration pushed both advanced and developing economies to unprecedented levels of growth in the period following World War II, though often, admittedly, unevenly distributed, the benefits of international trade pulled and are still pulling hundreds of millions of people out of extreme poverty, famine, and epidemic diseases. Historical examples show that escalating tariff conflicts result in no winners. In the long run, a trade war depresses economic growth for all countries involved. Trade wars reduce international trade and cause global recession. Both the United States and Europe, in particular, cannot afford a trade war since both economies are slowing down and the effect of another blow could be stronger. Important in the context of this conference is how trade wars could affect shipping, how the decline of global trade could negatively affect the economy in the maritime sector, and how trading routes and the shipping industry would have to be redirected. There is a geopolitical aspect as well. Tariffs are used as a means to slow China's economic rise and check the growing power of a geopolitical competitor. This friction is systemic too. It involves ideologies and the way of doing business. To a lesser degree, competition with the European Union also reflects geopolitical considerations. Ladies and gentlemen, the refugee and migration issue is taking on. Population movements are already on the rise and could become massive. This is an issue that will only intensify in the future. Because despite wars or other crises that occasionally aggravate it, mass movements of people in search of a better future will not stop. This is a very intricate question affecting broader areas around the world. It is not only a European problem. It confronts also the United States and the developed world in general. European countries, particularly in the South, experience an ever-increasing influx of refugees as well as migrants. No individual country can address such a question by itself. So far, however, the European Union has been unable to formulate a comprehensive and effective policy. Certainly, there is a strong humanitarian dimension to this issue in terms of the support and solidarity our societies have to show towards people in grave need. On the other hand, we all understand that there is a limit not to be surpassed. Questions of social cohesion, political stability, even cultural identity are already underway and shall probably become more acute in the years ahead. The unprecedented numbers arriving put an enormous stress on the ability of existing asylum systems to absorb such high volumes, providing people with food, shelter, healthcare, security, also has surpassed the resources of some European countries, especially Greece and Italy. Steps must be taken urgently in the spirit of burden sharing by relocating asylum seekers who are already in Europe. But not everyone who comes to Europe needs protection. We should be able to better detect illegal migrants. Repatriation agreements should be applied more efficiently. These will also work as a counter-incentive for unmanaged migrants. Our objective should be managed migration. In the cases where and when, migration addresses actual economic and labor needs, thereby directing people to legal and safe routes. Migrant smugglers must be legally persecuted. Almost 90% of refugees and migrants have been the victims of organized crime and smugglers to get them across. Moreover, borders must be controlled better, and countries like Turkey should be obliged to honor their commitments. Nevertheless, ladies and gentlemen, all the above does not solve the problem. It postpones it. It may, for the time being, alleviate it. It may even occasionally get it off the prime time publicity. But in reality, unless the fundamental causes of the phenomenon are tackled, it will keep haunting us. Poverty, privation, political turmoil, ethnic, civil, and tribal wars are the deeper roots of the problem. As long as millions of people choose to risk their lives and their kin's lives in desperate search for a better future, there is no long-term solution. It goes without saying that addressing it is a challenge of unprecedented dimensions for investment and financial aid, coordination, global coordination, and leadership. Ladies and gentlemen, regardless of climate change and the science behind it, natural disasters are becoming more and more frequent, even if, as some argue, global warming is more due to periodic climate changes as those observed in a mega-scale historic course and less to human behavior, the issue remains and is acute. As projected, a 2 degrees Celsius temperature rise may prove catastrophic across the world, a threat of almost existential dimensions. The record of our reaction to this global threat has not been promising. Many international conferences have taken place since 1992, but despite eloquent lip service, performance in real terms has been poor. The Paris Agreement, December 2015, and more recently the urge of the United Nations, only last September, set more ambitious targets, but it remains highly uncertain if it will lead to tangible progress. The United States' withdrawal from the agreement casts an obscure shadow to the overall prospects of the endeavor. The question is, at the same time, deeply political and geopolitical. The realization of the problem has not significantly altered our behavior. Mankind has not in practice shown the willingness to assume the serious costs involved. Governments are more often than not prone to push the necessary measures to the future. And as Yuval Noah Harari has put it in his 2016 bestseller Homo Deus, and I quote, 1 billion Chinese and 1 billion Indians aspire to live as middle-class Americans do and don't see the reason to shelve their dream, watching an Americans unwilling to give up their jeeps and shopping malls. It is true that the solutions proposed are directly affecting national economic interests. And it is hard to justify difficult political decisions on abstract long-term challenges. A lot will depend on specifying more concretely how to reconcile climate strategy and avoiding unintended consequences on economic development. We need to demonstrate in practice that the energy transition is possible while growing the economy and preserving the competitiveness of businesses. Technology innovations generate optimism for this transition towards a low-carbon economy. But without major advances in clean energy technology, there will always be a divide between powering economic growth and phasing out fossil fuels. As long as this divide persists, it will be difficult for countries to make bold climate commitments. Let me also drop a word or two as regards maritime transport. The IMO has set quite ambitious targets for 2013 and beyond. To meet them, it shall be necessary to improve the quality of the fuels by the refineries, limit the use of horsepower resulting to lower speeds, and intensify research in order to come up in the near future, hopefully, with more environmentally friendly alternative fuels. Ladies and gentlemen, let me for the final minutes of this speech turn to more political questions. All of us are well acquainted with the pivotal role social inequalities have played in history on both levels, the international and the domestic. In regard to the first, many conflicts and tensions can be attributed to it. In our days, massive migratory waves have been the direct outcome of excessive differences of standards of living between countries, but also world regions as well. On the domestic level, social inequalities have often provoked clashes, political turmoil, and occasionally far-reaching revolutions. The fact that in time, more and more wealth is accumulated in the hands of fewer individuals, and the gap between the haves and the have-nots is constantly widening, is disturbing. In regard to social cohesion, political stability, and the quality of our democracies. According to Oxfam, the 62 richest people have as much wealth as half the world. What turns, however, social inequalities into a major and pressing global challenge of our times is the prospect that due to economic developments and technological breakthroughs, they may climax dramatically in the near future. It is a big question what percentage of the population will have the skills to actively participate in the production process, the financial transactions, and the professional mobility of the near future. If already growing parts of our societies feel as being left behind, as outsiders in the emerging economic reality, it is easy to imagine how this tendency may assume critical dimensions. Furthermore, what will the future behold for all those, among them even doctors and lawyers, let alone drivers, teachers, blue-collar production liners, and others, whose professions shall be substituted by new generation computers and robots? Still more crucial, how many may have the privilege to enjoy advanced medical treatment? Medicine is making dramatic progress. Life expectancy is increasing. Fatal diseases are in the process of being cured. But the cost of all these innovations is immense, a nightmare for insurance companies and social security systems. What percentage of any given society shall have access to that, and how shall the left-outs react? A final note on this chapter. It is not primarily deprivation or poverty that provoke indignation, unrest, and eventually rebellion. It is comparison with the more privileged ones. And even more, it is anxiety about the future. The gilets jaunes, that is the yellow vests recently in France, revolted in France and obliged the government into an awkward compromise. Not because they were starving, but because they see themselves on the fringes of the new economy and worry about their future and the future of their kids. Ladies and gentlemen, this global context cannot be faced with the tools of the past. It is new. It is unpredictable. It creates new challenges for all of us. The impact of these changes in people's lives is in most cases overwhelming. Hence, it generates anxiety. It leads to disappointment and distrust in political institutions. This volatility and confusion is reflected on the fragmentation of the political system. The two-party system, which prevailed in the past in almost all European states, was the product of a more defined orientation of the electorate due to the realistic expectation of a steady improvement of living standards. Today, new political formations have overshadowed or almost completely replaced traditional old parties. An even more eloquent reflection of the current instability and perplexity is the rekindling of secessionist movements. During the last decade or so, we witnessed an overall strengthening of radical, even extremist voices, to the detriment of moderate and more reasonable expressions. This breeds populism, because populism feeds on distrust and disillusionment. Populism pretends to offer simplistic solutions to intricate problems, but this usually ends to heavy costs in the long term. The role of the media and the question of accurate and impartial information is also critical. Information that would allow for free choice. When information serves vested interests, free choice is being compromised. By extension, social media are adding to nowadays confusion. They may, on the one hand, encourage participation and draw attention on certain concerns of the society. But on the other hand, fake news spread through this channel are the consequent disorientation and misinformation provoked is a crucial issue. In other words, popular disappointment and anxiety, populism and radicalization of politics, rising social inequalities do cast a long shadow on the smooth functioning of our democracies. It is urgent to reassess the prospects, start paying more attention to the needs of our co-citizens, talk frankly, and set our priorities. The global challenges ahead may test us all. They have at least one thing in common. No country, no government, let alone political party, can address them by itself. High time to sit down together, focus on the real issues, and learn to discuss, and above all, to work together. Ladies and gentlemen, it is said that we are witnessing the twilight of leadership. True, that compared with legendary figures of the past, even the relatively near past, modern leaders seem to fall short. Perplexity of the problems and media overexposure do not help either. However, demanding times ask for foresight, decisiveness, respect for the people, and eyes set on the long term. The aforementioned global challenges ahead may be, as so often in the past, the fertilizer for high-quality leadership. As an outstanding statesman and long-serving British Prime Minister put it, quote, "Life is too short to be little. Man is never so manly as when he feels deeply, acts boldly, and express himself with frankness and with fervor." This man was Benjamin Disraeli. Let us all have an eye for his likes in the years to come. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you.